One advance I'm really hoping for in the future is driverless cars. I really hate driving unless it's at ludicrous speed. Now, that's just fun. My requirements for the driverless car are very simple. I need it to accept a location, drive me to the destination, and wake me when it gets there. I really don't care what company does it first or how it gets done. The car just has to be capable of performing my three tasks. You can think of these car tasks as a contract of three methods for a class: set location, drive, wake me up. That's what an interface is. It's a contract that states that any class implementing this interface can be typed as the interface, and it guarantees the methods listed in the interface will be implemented. So, let's talk about how interfaces work and how we can use them in our applications. When defining an interface, we use the keyword interface instead of class. That's pretty much the biggest difference. Interfaces must be public or package scope. If you don't specify the scope of the interface, it's package scope. We can have attributes in an interface, but the catch is all attributes must be public, static, and final. That's a constant. Even if we don't declare the attribute scope, Java makes the attribute public, static, and final. The reason is interfaces are contracts. They can't hold state. If we need state, we should use classes. Sometimes we'll see a constant interface pattern. The idea is we put a bunch of constants in an interface and we add the interface where we need it. It's a really bad idea and it's considered an anti-pattern. If you ever find yourself wanting to create a constant interface, put the constants in a final class. In most cases, interfaces are only method declarations and do not implement any of the methods. We'll cover the exception soon. When we talk about interfaces, we're not talking about the is-a relationship we see with inheritance. We say the class implements or does X. We use the keyword implements on our class. If we use the interface as a type, it points to a class instance that implements the interface. We cannot create an instance of an interface. Sometimes we see interfaces used to describe an is-a relationship as well. It's usually when the interface is used as the type for the class. I prefer to use the words does, acts like, or implements when describing the relationship between interface concepts. We can create a hierarchy of interfaces. In this case, we're extending the contract of methods with more methods. We'll use the keyword extends. In Java, we usually add the word able after the name. So if the interface's purpose is to be self-driving, we might name the interface self-drivable. It's a weird convention, and you'll see some very strange mental gymnastics to create an interface with a name that can end in able. My recommendation is try your best. If the interface name would be clear without the able suffix, you can skip it. The other option is to prefix the interface with the word can, as in can self-drive. Recently, the people at Java ran into a situation where they were painted into a corner. Most of their collection classes are defined using interfaces. They wanted to add functional programming to their interfaces, but if they changed the interface, it would break every class using the interface. The interfaces are a fundamental part of Java, so it would break other people's code. To solve this problem, they added something called default or defender methods to the interfaces. Defender methods enable us to add new functionality to interfaces, but ensure binary compatibility with the code written for older versions of those interfaces. This means we can provide default functionality for some methods. To do this, we use the keyword default when defining the method and provide the default implementation of the method. The method should work for all implementations of the interface, and it looks like a normal method. It doesn't need to be static, and it can call other interface methods. Defender methods can lead to a situation where two interfaces provide a defender method with the same name. In this case, the code will not compile, and we cannot use the two interfaces together. When we have an interface that extends another interface, we can call any super interface defender method. We do this using the interface name with the super keyword. Sometimes you'll see an interface containing no methods at all. It's just an empty interface. These are called marker interfaces. They inform the compiler the objects of the classes implementing the marker interface needs to be treated differently. An example of this is in Java is the serializable interface. Serializable says, this object can be copied, stored to disk, and then recreated. There's conventions, but there are no methods we're forced to implement. Java won't let you serialize an object unless you tell the compiler it's okay. The marker interface does that by checking for the interface type. There's one other type of interface, and it's called a functional interface. This is an interface containing exactly one method. It's also marked with something called an annotation. The annotation isn't required, but it's recommended. The annotation lets the compiler know it should enforce single abstract method inside the interface. These interfaces are important for functional programming in lambdas. Those we'll cover later, but you should be aware of what a functional interface is. The first thing that might come to mind is, how are these different from abstract classes? An abstract class is a partially completed class. It's up to us to complete the class when we derive from it. Since it's a class, you can only inherit from a single class. If we want to add or change behavior, abstract classes force us to use inheritance. Interfaces say we promise to implement the methods listed in the interface, but there's no limit to the number of interfaces our class can implement. Our classes are free to use as many interfaces as needed, and that's why I say does is a better relationship word for interfaces. A class usually represents one concept, but it can do many actions. The most common use for interfaces is to hide the details of a class. If we look at the list interface in Java, it contains many methods for manipulating a list. Behind the interface curtain, there's many types of lists. There's an array list, a linked list, a vector, and so on. With the list interface, we're separating what each class does from how it does it. The actual class used doesn't matter. If we need to change the class behind the scenes, say a different class handles large lists better than the one we're using, we can swap the class without needing to change much code. This is called programming to an interface. In most cases, we want to avoid inheritance. We should use abstract classes only when we want to include functionality, but parts of the class's purpose need to be implemented by the child class. With abstract classes, you're forcing other developers to implement child classes using inheritance. Interfaces are much easier to add to existing classes, and with defender methods, there's little reason to not consider interfaces first. All right, that was a long tutorial. Thank you for making it to the end. If you have any questions, let me know in the comments below. Liking the video helps me understand what I'm doing right, so if you like the video, you know what to do. And with that, I'll see you in the next tutorial.